it is a great pleasure and privilege to be in a position to introduce a distinguished speaker today, Katsuhito Iwai of University of Tokyo, as the 7th John W. Hall Lecture in Japanese Studies. Professor John W. Hall taught at Yale, and he was a prominent Japan studies scholar, as Edwin Reischauer was so in Harvard. John Hall studied Ashikaga period, middle age of Japan, and in various academic activities, he really was a driving force to promote studies in Japanese history and Japanese studies at Yale. Also, he was the interpreter of Kanichi Asakawa, an economic historian from Japan, who came to teach here and study about the mana or shōen system in Japan. Mr. Hall has a very integrated personality, and by his wife's benevolent donations, this lecture was founded. And I think Mr. Iwai is the second economist, if we count Su Hanle as the economic historian, as an economist, then he is the third economist here. Probably you memorize only in essential things and not important things. My memory of John Hall was that when I talked to him with this English, he said, "Do you teach Japanese economy in Japanese or English?" "In English." And say, "Of course, in English." Then he answered, "Probably economics is simple enough for you to teach in English." But anyway, as an afterthought, it's a quite upsetting remark, but I didn't feel any emotion. He's always gentle and kind and embracing. Today's speaker, Katsuhito Iwai, has a brilliant or tremendous vita, and I can spend hours how his work influenced economics, and particularly in economics in Japan, but I would like to speak only a little bit among his many prizes. This year, a purple ribbon prize from the Japanese government was added. And usually, purple ribbon, Shiju Hosho, is considered as a mini or junior cultural medal that is equivalent to Legion d'honneur in France. So it's a great honor. And he may get a senior cultural medal sometime. he graduated from MIT, taught at Kohl's Foundation and other places, as is written. But at Kohl's Foundation, he polished his dissertation at MIT into a large book called Disequilibrium Dynamics. And he got Grand Prix, the best distinguished economics book prize for that. And his point was, usually at that time, rational expectation school was in full bloom, and everything flexible, adjustment by price mechanism, was a good thing. But he doubted that. And what happens if every price moves like Wall Street stock price or so? Sometimes rigidity in price or wage can be a stabilizer for the macroeconomic to perform. And later, and this was skepticism to the mainstream of Western economics. And his trend continues to his series of work, What Will Become of the Corporation, today's topic. Again, standard economist or law and economist argues that stockholders, shareholders are the ultimate residual claimer, so they should monitor best, and by monitoring executive branches by shareholders well, then the economics and incentives scheme and price mechanism will work. Again, he doubt, he cast skepticism to that kind of notion. Really, stockholders can always manipulate executives as agents. There should be different, could be different kind of relationship between stockholders and executive branch of the firm. So he, in spite of his great mastery of neoclassical economics or tradition, he always has some mind cool towards the soft point of the traditional or ongoing doctrine. And he does it very skillfully, not necessarily in technical language, but in language or languages to be understandable to other branch of people. He has many friends in literary critics or novelist. Minae Mizumura is his wife, inclusive of her. And political scientist, philosopher, and so forth. So the one of the prizes he got is called Kobayashi Hideo. Probably Japan specialist would know what Kobayashi Hideo is. It's the godfather of Japanese literary critics. So he has great talent of speaking and writing clearly in general languages. And I am pleased, very pleased to introduce Professor Katsuhito Iwai to the podium. He would like accept some very clarifying question or so. He would like to deliver his lecture for 1 hour or less, and then we will open the discussion. Professor Iwai.
Yeah, thank you very much, Professor Hamada. Professor Hamada has always been a generous teacher and generous friend to me. And he continues to be generous by having invited me back to Yale. Yeah, indeed, I'm very happy to be back at Yale. Being a young, being poor, being assistant professor, it was one of the most productive years in my whole academic life. And I'm also very, very much honored to be able to give a lecture that bears the name of the late Professor John Whitney Hall. When I was at Yale, I saw him several times, but being a mere assistant professor, working on a very abstract economic theory, I did not have courage to talk to him in person. But I had read some of his writings and admired him in private. Here are the quotations from some of his writings. The first fragment is from his textbook on Japan, and the rest are from his well-known article on Japanese feudalism. I don't have time to read these passages in full, but what I gather from these passages is that Professor Ho's approach to Japanese society and history is comparative and theoretical. It is neither to treat Japan as an exotic curiosity, nor to identify in Japan a pattern of history that is identical with that of Western Europe. Indeed, what Professor Ho tried to show in his numerous writings on Japan is that to study Japan from a comparative perspective is to broaden our understanding of human development that embraces more than one culture. It is indeed to enlarge what is common in human institutions, what is general in human cultures, and what is universal in human societies. Now, this tribute to Professor Ho leads me back to the title of this lecture. If you look at this title in the PowerPoint slide, you may notice a slight change I made to the title from the one announced. Yes. I have placed a parenthesis around the word Japanese. This is to indicate that this talk is intended to be in the spirit of Professor Ho. It is to indicate that to study Japanese society, in particular Japanese corporate systems, is neither to treat it as an exotic curiosity, nor to identify in it a pattern identical with that of the United States or Western Europe. It is rather to enlarge our understanding of what is universal in societies, or more specifically, what is universal in corporate systems, by presenting a theory that can embrace more than one economy. So much for the introduction, and let me start my lecture. As some of you may know, I'm a theoretical economist by training, but in the last 15 years, I have also been working on the Japanese economy, especially on the history and the structure of the Japanese corporate system. And some of my papers this lecture will be based upon are an outgrowth, indeed, an unexpected outgrowth of those studies. They are at the back of, at the end of the handout. You can find some of my papers. Yeah. I said unexpected outgrowth because somewhere in the process of studying the history and the structure of the Japanese corporate system, I began to ask myself a very naive question, what is corporation? And soon found myself working on a very unfamiliar territory, a territory mostly inhabited by legal scholars, philosophers, sociologists, political theorists, and historians, as you may see. Now, please look at this table. Okay. This table reports the results of a 1988 survey that asked corporate managers in America, Japan, and Europe to pick out the three most important goals of their management goals, management policies. Please look at the first column. Okay. American managers rank the rate of return on investment at the top, and the capital gains of shareholders the second. So you can see that the answers given by American corporate managers were entirely consistent with a traditional assumption in economics that the whole purpose of the business corporation is to maximize the returns to its shareholders. Now please look at the second one in Japan. Now, in stark contrast to American counterparts, Japanese corporate managers placed capital gains of shareholders at the very bottom of their ranking. Okay? Instead, they put the ratio of new products at the top and ranked the expansion of market share the second. And these two goals are more or less related to the survival and the growth of the corporation as a business organization. The answer given by European, misplacement here, but the answers given by European corporate managers, however, somewhat murky. This is probably due to the diversity of the countries in this category. Okay? Of course, let me remind you that this study was conducted almost 20 years ago, and the outlook of the Japanese corporate managers have changed very much since then. So I will come back to this problem in the last part of this talk, in which I will discuss the future of the Japanese corporate system in what will be called post-industrial capitalism. Okay? In any case, what I believe is that even now, there still remains a wide difference between American corporations and Japanese corporations. That is, the major objective of American corporate managers is the maximization of shareholders' returns, whereas the chief concern of many Japanese corporate managers remains the survival and growth of the corporation as an organization. However, in spite of this wide difference in attitudes toward the purpose of the corporation, okay, both America and Japan are full-fledged capitalist economies with similar corporate laws. Okay. Indeed, the current Japanese corporate laws can be regarded as an amalgam of German law and American law. So there emerges a puzzle, a theoretical puzzle we have to solve. How can these seemingly contradictory systems of cooperation coexist within the same institutional framework of capitalism? And before, I have already given some hint about my answer, but before giving an answer to this question, please allow me to indulge in the history of social sciences for a while. Now, if you open up a book of legal history, we find that for many centuries, legal scholars and legal philosophers have debated heatedly on as to what constitutes the essence or the nature of cooperation. This is called corporate personality controversy, one of the most celebrated controversies in legal theory and legal philosophy. And in this age-old controversies, two competing legal theories have emerged. One is corporate nominalism, and the other is corporate realism. And what is called corporate realism, corporate nominalism, asserts that the corporation is a mere name for association of individuals. In opposition, what is called corporate realism asserts that corporation is a full-fledged entity that is independent of its members, its individual members. And the corporate personality controversy is not a thing of the past. A similar controversy has continued up until now, and also in my own field, economics. On the one hand, here, the so-called the contractual theory of the firm, started by Ronald Coase, is a direct descendant of corporate nominalism. And this can easily be seen by the following remarks by two of its most important advocates, Professor Jensen and Meckling. They say that private corporations are simply legal fictions which serve as a nexus for a set of contracting relationships among individuals. On the other hand, the so-called the evolutionary theory of the firm, or the organizational capability approach to the firm, can be classified as a modern representative of corporate realism. One of its champions, Sidney Winter, one of my former colleagues, posit corporate firms as organizations that know how to do things while individual members come and go. You see, the same, almost identical controversy has been repeated in theory, in law for a millennium, in economics for almost a century. And each of these two opposing theories on the nature of cooperation has as its real-life counterpart the American corporate system and the Japanese corporate system, respectively. And this observation now leads me to speculate that it must be the very nature or very legal nature of cooperation that is responsible for the coexistence of the two seemingly contradictory forms of cooperation, both in reality and in theory. Then we have to ask the question I have asked a long time ago, what is cooperation? What is this animal called cooperation? And in order to answer this question, I'll make a short detour and examine what is not a cooperation first. So next year. And this is a mom and pop grocery shop as example of a firm not incorporated. It's a textbook model of the firm I teach usually in classroom in economics. Now suppose you are owner of this mom and pop grocery shop, and you have worked hard for the whole day, and you feel hungry. And you are an honest grocer, and you know that apples on the shelf taste good. So you pick up one of the apples on the shelf and eat it right away. What will happen to you? Nothing, except that you have to endure the angry face of your spouse, your co-owner. The apple is your property, and you are free to dispose of your private property in any manner you like. You can sell it to your customer and earn money, you can eat it, or you can just give it to somebody. This diagram shows that the textbook model of the farm has the simplest possible structure. Okay? It consists of a single ownership relationship between an owner or a set of owners, in the case of partnership, or like our mom-and-pop grocery shop, okay? And assets such as apples, oranges, on the shelf of the grocery store. However, as soon as a farm is incorporated and becomes a business corporation, its ownership structure undergoes a fundamental change. Okay? Suppose this is a supermarket chain. It is supposed to be an incorporated farm or business corporation. Okay? Suppose you are an owner of this corporation. And you are a grocery store worker, and you worked hard for the whole day in a nearby grocery shop, and you felt hungry. Suppose further that on your way back to home, you happen to be in front of the supermarket of which you are a shareholder. As I said, you are hungry. Okay? And if you march into the shop, grab an apple from its shelf, and eat it right away, what will happen to you? You will be arrested as a thief, okay? Even if you are a shareholder of this supermarket chain. Then we have to ask why. It is because a corporate shareholder is not the legal owner of the corporate assets. You are arrested simply because you took somebody else's property. Okay. Who then is the owner of these corporate assets? The answer is here. Okay. The answer is the corporation as a legal person. Okay. So a new concept has been introduced, it is legal person. So then what does it mean by the corporation as a legal person? In order to answer this question, okay, we now have to open up a book on corporate law. Okay. Here I have a quotation from American Bar Association's Revised Model of Business Corporate Act. Okay. It says that every corporation has the same power as an individual to do things necessary or convenient to carry out its business and affairs. For instance, GM is a corporation. Toyota is a corporation. And Yale is a corporation. And the University of Tokyo is also a corporation. That each of these institutions has a legal personality means that it owns property as a person does, it makes contract with others as a person does, and it becomes a litigant in lawsuit as a person does. For example, this building is owned by Yale as a legal person. Professor Hamada and Professor Brainard and so on are hired by Yale as a legal person. Okay? Obviously, a corporation is not a human being, so it is just a thing. Okay? But it is treated as a person in the system of law. Okay? So, thus, the legal person can be defined as a thing, okay, treated as a person in law. So it's a thing treated as a person in law. That's a definition of legal person. Okay. You have to notice here that already in this most elementary characterization, the two opposing natures are attributed to cooperation: personness, personality, and thingness. It is a thing that is treated legally as a person, so it has a dual nature of person and thing. So you can see the cooperation is a very strange animal, indeed. I have now shown you that it is the corporation itself as a legal person that owns corporate assets. The next question is, if a corporate shareholder is not the owner of corporate assets, then what does she or he own? The answer is the corporation as a thing. As I said, the corporation has a dual nature of person and thing. And we have already seen its person side. So it is then the turn of its thing side that has to be exposed now. And it is a corporation as a thing that a corporate shareholder legally owns. Indeed, corporate shareholder is literally a holder of a share of the corporation. And to hold a share of the corporation is to own a fraction or a share of the corporation as a thing separate and distinct from its underlying asset. Now, as we all know that in a capitalist economy, anything can become a commodity and has its market. And obviously, the corporation as a thing also has a market. It is, of course, the stock market, a share market. Okay. The stock market is a market for the corporation as a thing. It is a market where shares of each corporation are bought and sold daily as commodities. And it is not the market for corporate assets, as is often supposed in the textbook of economics and finance. And this observation will lead us to the most fundamental characterization of the business corporation. Please look at this left-hand side of this whole diagram, whole slide. In contrast to a textbook firm like the mom and pop grocery shop, whose ownership structure has this simple one-tier structure, a business corporation is composed of not one, but two ownership relationships. Okay. First, the shareholders own the corporation as a thing. Okay. Then the corporation in turn as a person owns corporate assets. Okay. In fact, if you look at this two-tier ownership structure of the corporation, you can see the corporation's person-thing duality in full relief. In regard to corporate assets, a corporation acts legally as a person, as a subject of property right. Okay? And in regard to shareholders, real persons, real people, the corporation is acted on as a thing, as an object of a property right. Okay? Indeed, once we have characterized the corporation as such two-tier ownership structure, the great part of the law of corporation becomes easily understandable. I will not go in detail, but for example, okay, this explains easily why shareholders have only a limited liability status, whereas the owners of unincorporated firms are subject to unlimited liabilities. Okay. For example, okay, in the case of an unincorporated firm, like our grocery store shop, its loan contract is its owner's loan contract. Okay? When a grocery store goes bankrupt, the bank or the creditor can claim not only apples and oranges in the shop, but also personal assets of its owners, our poor mom and pop. In contrast, when the corporation goes bankrupt, the bank can seize only the assets of the corporation. The bank cannot touch the assets of corporate shareholders because the loan contract of the corporation is the loan contract of the corporation as a legal person, not the loan contract of its shareholders. And this is nothing but the so-called limited liability of corporate shareholders. And this two-tier ownership structure of the corporation also indicates that the director of the corporation are not the agents of shareholders, but fiduciaries of the corporation. As a matter of fact, my current research agenda is to develop a general theory of fiduciary relationships, but I do not have time to go into that topic now. More important for our discussion is that this two-tier structure of corporation, two-tier ownership structure of the corporation enables us to resolve the controversy as to the nature of the corporation, both in reality and in theory. In fact, if we look only at upstairs of this two-tier structure, the corporation appears merely as a thing owned and controlled by shareholders, and we draw near to the position of corporate nominalism and to that of American corporate system. And if you look only at the lower half, downstairs, the corporation appears fully as a person owning and managing corporate assets, and we draw near to the position of corporate realism and to that of Japanese corporate system. Indeed, we can go further. What I'm going to demonstrate is that there are even ways to eliminate either personality or thingness from the corporation, thereby turning the corporation into a mere thing or a full person, respectively. Now, the way to eliminate personality from the corporation, from a corporation, is simple, indeed very trivial. It is to have someone own more than 50% of its shares. That someone then acquires almost absolute control over the corporation. Legally speaking, the corporation is still the sole owner of the corporate assets, but in practice, it is the dominant shareholders who can exercise the ultimate control over these assets. So we are certainly in the world of the corporate nominalism here. I have to skip. If I had enough time in this talk, I would like to explain how the mere potentiality of takeovers, hostile takeovers in the stock market, may discipline corporate managers to maximize share values. But I have to skip the argument here. And in any case, what I have shown is that there is a legal mechanism that is able to eliminate the personality almost completely from the corporation. I'm now going to argue or demonstrate that there also exists a legal mechanism that is able to eliminate the thingness from the corporation almost completely. Now, this is it. Now, we know that as a person, a corporation can own things. And we also know that as a legal thing, a corporation can be owned by persons. This implies that a corporation as a person can, in principle, own itself as a thing, like this. Corporation as a person can own itself as a thing. Indeed, nothing prevents us from imagining a corporation that becomes its own controlling shareholders by holding a majority block of its own shares under its own name. If this were indeed possible, that corporation would be free from any control by real human beings and acquire a full personality in the province of law. But one might dismiss this as idle speculation. Okay? Many countries prohibit the corporation from repurchasing its own shares. Okay? And in other countries, such as the United States, which allow shareholders, share repurchases, sorry, the repurchased shares are treated as treasury shares. By treasury shares, I mean shares that are always kept in the treasury box of corporation and can never exercise their voting rights in shareholders' meeting. Japan used to prohibit share repurchases, but the ban was prohibited in 1995. But as in the United States, the repurchased shares are deprived of their voting rights in Japan. In the real economy, it appears impossible for the corporation to become its own owner. There is, however, a leeway to this, important leeway to this. Please look at this famous picture by Dutch abstract painter Escher. Okay? It will give you a hint of about this leeway. In this picture, the right hand is drawing the left hand, and the left hand is also drawing the right hand. But the right hand, this means that the right hand is drawing itself through the intermediary of the left hand, and vice versa for the left hand. Likewise, imagine a situation where two corporations, A and B, hold the majority of each other's shares. The corporation A, as a person, owns the corporation B as a thing, and the corporation B as a person in turn owns corporation A as a thing. Okay? Even though each corporation does not own itself directly, okay, it does so indirectly through the intermediary of the other corporation. One might still object to the practical possibility of this leeway by pointing out that some countries impose legal limits on the extent of mutual shareholdings between corporations. For instance, Japanese law prohibits banks from owning more than 5% of the shares of any domestic corporation. Or also Japanese law prohibits subsidiaries own its parent company's shares. Yet it is possible to escape even from these limits. There's a way to escape from these limits. Suppose that 12 corporations, A, B, C, D, there are 12 corporations. The 12 corporations get together in a meeting and decide to hold 5% of each other's shares. The result is a simple arithmetic. 12 minus 1 is 11. And each own 5% and 55%. So each corporation would have 55% of its shares owned by the remaining 11 corporations in that meeting. This tells us that a majority block of each corporation's shares could be effectively sealed off from real human beings without violating any of the above mentioned legal limits, legal restrictions on mutual shareholdings. These 12 corporations together would indeed become their own owners, at least as a group. So it is therefore practically impossible to prevent corporations from becoming their own owners if they so wish. But one might still dismiss all this as idle speculation of armchair selection. Okay? So you have to ask, is there any reality to this? Then please look at this table. This table exhibits a matrix of shareholdings among 20 corporations that constitute the core members of the Sumitomo Keiretsu Group in 1993. Okay. What is remarkable in this table is that their network of cross shareholdings is so tightly knit that this matrix has few vacant cells except diagonal ones. Okay? Diagonal ones are, by definition, zero. So we have thus seen a real-life application of the legal mechanism that can turn a group of corporations into that of purely realistic corporations. I hope that I have demonstrated how the age-old controversies on the nature of the cooperation can be resolved by having shown you two legal mechanisms. Okay? One turning person come thing cooperation into a mere thing, okay? Into a purely nominalist cooperation, okay? And the other turning a person come thing cooperation into a full person, into a purely realistic cooperation. Okay? What I have established is the fact that legal institution of cooperation has provided each society with a menu, a long menu of corporate forms from which it can choose. Each society can choose any position along a long spectrum that runs from nominalistic end, purely nominalistic form, to a purely realistic form. Okay? And on the basis of, or at least under the influence of economic efficiency, political interest, ideological forces, cultural traditions, historical evolution, and other extra-legal factors. And in the long history of their capitalist development, the American economy has chosen from this long legal menu the position close to the nominalistic end as its dominant form of the cooperation. And the Japanese economy has chosen the position close to the realistic end as its dominant form until, at least until 1990s. Now, it is no secret that the traditional Japanese style management has completed its historical mission. The stock market and property market bubbles burst in 1990s and brought down the entire Japanese economy to a long stagnation during the 1990s. Okay. And Japanese Japanese cross-shareholding has been weakened, unraveled recently. And indeed, the percentage share of the cross-shareholdings has rapidly declining from about 20%, in fact, 18.5% in 1987 to 7.6% in 2003. At the same time, some of the six large Keiretsu groups, Mitsubishi, Mitsui, Sumitomo, Fuyo, Daiichi Kangin, and Sanwa, began to lose their grips on their member corporations. They are now consolidated into three groups, okay? Mitsubishi, Sumitomo Mitsui, and Mizuho, and there may be more reshuffling in the future. And the bottom diagram also shows that there has been a rapid rise in the merger and acquisition in recent years. So does these facts mean that the long-run tide of the corporate system is in the nominalistic direction? Is there a convergence towards the American corporate system? The answer I would like to give is no. Indeed, I'm also discerning another strong tide, okay, moving in the opposite direction. Okay? It is a tide brought about by the transition of the advanced capitalist economies from the stage of industrial capitalism to the stage of post-industrial capitalism. In order to explain this, I have to re-examine nominalism, realism dichotomy of corporate forms from the standpoint of economic efficiency. Sorry, I have to introduce economics here. Okay? And in fact, we have learned from the recent literature on economics, that two of the most important sources of inefficiency in economic organizations are the moral hazard problem and the hold-up problem. Okay? First, by the moral hazard problem, okay, I mean inefficiency caused by the separation of control and ownership in corporate organization. Okay? Inside our organizations, such as workers, engineers, researchers, and managers may take advantage of the shareholders' weak monitoring of their performances and covertly pursue their private interest at the expense of shareholders. For instance, managers may build their perks, okay, engineers may indulge in toy making, and workers may simply goof off. Okay? The hold-up problem, on the other hand, is concerned with another kind of inefficiency. Okay? For a corporate organization to survive and grow, its workers, engineers, researchers, and managers have to develop skills, know-how, technologies, technology communication networks, visions, and so on, that are specialized to the organization. Okay? In economics, okay, they are called organization-specific human capital. But these employees are in a vulnerable position. Okay? It is because the organization-specific human capital has, by definition, little or no value outside of the organization. Once these employees have invested their time and efforts in organization-specific human capital, their vulnerable position may be exploited by shareholders who are seeking only short-term returns. Okay? For instance, a corporate raider may buy out their corporation and then slash out the fund for research and development in order to increase the dividend payout. Okay? For fear of such potential exploitation, these employees are reluctant to commit themselves to organization-specific human capital, even if the accumulation would enhance the economic value of the corporation. Okay? This is called the hold-up problem, and the so-called incomplete contract theory in economics is all about this. What I would like to suggest here is that there is a real trade-off between these two kinds of inefficiency, and that the choice of the legal form of cooperation, whether it is nominalistic or realistic, depends very much upon this trade-off. Okay. It is evident that the nominalist cooperation has an advantage over the realistic cooperation with respect to the moral hazard problem, because it allows the shareholders to monitor the performance of managers and other core employees, or it allows the stock market to pressure the manager to maximize returns for shareholders. But I also maintain that the realistic cooperation also has an advantage over the nominalist cooperation with respect to the hold-up problem. In the case of realistic cooperation, its commitment to the survival and growth of its own organization can work as a shield for organization-specific human capital and protect the core employees and manager, perhaps, from potential holdups by outside shareholders. It thus encourages those core employers to commit themselves to invest in organization-specific human capital. Indeed, I even claim that the realistic cooperation, with its long-term commitment to the survival and growth of its organization, can function as a de facto owner of organization-specific human capital. Now, let us come back to what I have referred earlier, the transition of capitalism from the industrial stage to post-industrial stage. By this transition, okay, I mean a recent shift in the major source of profits for corporations from the scale economy of large factory to skills, technologies, know-hows, visions, communication network, and so on of core workers, engineers, and managers of a corporation. What is critical to the long-run competitiveness of business cooperation is no longer the physical capital, but human capital, especially knowledge-based human capital. And indeed, there is a growing body of literature suggesting that the value of human capitals and other intangibles has shown a phenomenal rise in recent years in the United States and other countries. I'm afraid that I do not have time to discuss in detail how such a transition was brought about within the capitalist economy. And I just want to point out here that it is that depletion of surplus labor in rural area that set off this transition. In fact, here there's a Professor Rainis, and Rainis' famous model can explain this in this transition. Yeah. And this transition took place around 1950s and 1960s in the United States, and around 1970s and 1980s in Japan. I said that the knowledge-based human capital now occupies the central place in post-industrial capitalism, but this does not mean that any knowledge can be the source of profits for business corporations. Okay? Even if one has a very brilliant idea, if that idea can be accessed easily by others, or that idea can be imitated easily by others, it has no or little economic value. In the age of post-industrial capitalism, only the difference matters. That is, only the knowledge that is enclosed within the organization and cannot be easily transferred to outside of the organization can generate positive profits for business organization. And this is precisely what I have called organization-specific human capital. What does this mean to a nominalism-realism dichotomy of corporate form? The single most important characteristic of human capital is its inalienability. It's very hard for me to pronounce it, inalienability. Money can buy machines, factories, land, offices, and other physical capital. Physical capital is alienable. Money, however, cannot directly buy ideas, know-hows, skills, human networks, visions, and other human capital, especially knowledge-based human capital. Okay? Because they are all some forms of knowledge stored inside of our human brain, or our gray cells. Okay? Yeah, gray cells. The only thing money can do is to provide a variety of incentives that would encourage the employees to invest their time and effort on human capital. And in the era, or in the age of industrial capitalism, where the large factory system was the major source of profits, it was the shareholders who held the upper hand in the balance of power within a business corporation, because they are the ultimate suppliers of money that can buy factories and other productive facilities. Of course, you needed a lot of employees to operate factory system, but their role within an industrial organization remained subordinate to physical capital and hence to the shareholders. In contrast, in this new age of post-industrial capitalism, the physical capital has surrendered its central position to the knowledge-based human capital that money can no longer buy and control. The balance of power within a business organization, business corporation, is clearly tilting away from suppliers of money to suppliers of knowledge-based human capital, especially to those who contribute to organization-specific human capital. That is, from shareholders to workers, engineers, scientists, and managers who had made a long-term commitment to the corporate organization. So let me summarize what I have argued so far about the choice between two corporate systems. There are two fundamental sources of inefficiency in corporate organization: the moral hazard problem and the hold-up problem. Okay? And there is a trade-off between these two problems. Indeed, nominalist corporate system is able to solve or at least mitigate the moral hazard problem, but only at the expense of the hold-up problem. Hence, the nominalist corporation is better adapted to the stage of industrial capitalism because its major source of profits is physical capital over which shareholders had a direct control, whereas human capital was subordinate to physical capital. Okay. On the other hand, realistic cooperation or realistic corporate system has a comparative advantage in minimizing the holder problem, but of course at the expense of moral hazard problem. Okay. To the extent that organization-specific human capital plays a central role in corporations' capability of generating profits, I expect many business corporations will adopt realistic forms in this new era of post-industrial capitalism. So I now have to wind up my talk by giving some reports on the state of the Japanese corporate system in recent years. Okay? Although I have little time, so my report will be very short. As you know, okay, Sony and Toyota are two of the most well-known Japanese corporations in the world. But nothing is more opposed than their corporate governance systems. Sony's former management introduced American-style corporate governance more than a decade ago, and placed the maximization of the share value as one of its major management goals. Toyota, on the other hand, has tried doggedly to remain Japanese in their corporate governance style, which they call the Toyota way. And their recent performances are also markedly different. About 4 years ago, the Japanese stock market was hit by the so-called Sony shock. Because of a report of its lackluster performances, its share lost more than half of its value and has remained low until now. Okay. Sony seems to have lost its excellence in its organization's capability. In contrast, Toyota has now taken over GM in its sales volume and has become the number one car producer in the world. I have to skip number two, number three, number four. Maybe I have to mention that recently there is a re-emergence of cross-share holdings in Japan. Okay. And also they have a lot of introduction of anti-takeover measures in Japan. And also there is some corporation try to buy out, some corporation managers try to buy out their corporation and withdraw their stocks from the stock market. Let me just, I want to just look at the last slide, or penultimate slide, okay, in this presentation. I want to look at the most recent questionnaire study on corporate objectives in Japan. Okay. This study was conducted by Professor Tanaka, Kazuhiro Tanaka of Hitotsubashi University. He was very kind to me, kind enough to permit me to quote his study in this presentation. He posed to the Japanese corporate managers 9 questions and asked them to scale their answers from 1 to 7. One of the questions is, should share value be maximized? And if answer is yes, he or she should choose 1. And if the answer is no, then he or she should choose 7. And the corporate executives are also allowed to choose numbers in between. So there's another question is, who owns the corporation? And if the answer is shareholders, the point is 1. And if the answer is core employees, the point is 7. Okay. Also, in each question, Professor Tanaka also asked another question. What would have been your predecessor's answer 10 years ago? Now, if you look at this column, okay, for the total, then you can discern a trend in the nominalistic direction in contemporary Japan. Okay. 10 years ago, okay, the point was 4.7. It's quite sort of employee-oriented. Okay. But now it is 3.9. It's very hard to say this is shareholder oriented, but at least there's a move from employee oriented orientation to a shareholder orientation. Okay. So Japanese corporations seem to become increasingly shareholder oriented. And this is exactly what economists, both inside and outside Japan, believe is happening in Japan. Okay. Yet what captured my attention when I looked at these numbers was something different. Professor Tanaka divided the group into three subgroups. And what I noticed, I paid attention, is this third subgroup, okay? The corporations whose current average is above 4.5. That is those employee-oriented corporations, even among Japanese corporations. Okay? And their scores remain the same. Okay? In fact, to such questions, I have omitted to list those questions, to such questions as, should the shareholders be regarded as the sole power holder of the corporation? Or are the employees mere inputs for production of profits? Those corporation scores has increased markedly in the last 10 years. Okay? Despite the decade-long pressure from all around the world to move towards shareholder orientation, those corporations persisted doggedly to remain employee-oriented. And Toyota is included in this category. And the position of these employee-oriented corporations is currently being justified by the most post-industrial corporation, like Google. Okay. As you know, when Google made its share public in 2004, they arranged the whole thing in such a way that the Class A stock that was sold for general public had only 1/10 of the voting power of the Class B stocks that were held by insiders of the corporation, including their co-founders, Brin and Page. It was to ensure that their corporate decisions and their organizational identity should not be influenced too much by those shareholders who are seeking only short-term returns. So what will become of the Japanese corporate system? And also, I can also drop the Japanese from this title, what will become of the corporate system. Okay? And I'm not here to argue that one form of cooperation is better than the other. Okay? I'm here only to argue that both forms of corporations are legally, philosophically, and economically possible forms of cooperation. You can choose, that's the whole point. Okay? And I just believe that too much shift to the nominalistic direction may be counterproductive to the value creation of the corporation and ultimately to the wealth creation of the nation as a whole. Okay? In this new era of post-industrial capitalism, where luckily our brains, okay, yours and mine, are more important than shareholders' money. I think I should stop here. Thank you for your patience.
Yeah.
Yes, that's a very good question. In the case of Japanese corporation, stock options, of course, there has been recent introduction of stock options some in some corporations, but very limited. And no, there is no restriction. And so it's not the problem with legal restrictions. It's a decision made by Japanese corporation. Okay? And interesting thing is that in Japan, there has been an increase in so-called managerial buyout. Okay? And that is also very interesting because, I mean, it is one way to reintroduce what is called Japanese corporate management style two decades ago. For example, some corporations like, you may not know the Japanese corporate names, but Pokka or Skylark, the managers decided to buy out the corporations by financing the buyout money from banks or some big funds. And then they withdraw their shares from stock market, and they become sort of, just like owner-controlled corporations. But the point is that, I mean, even if they are owner-controlled, okay, most of the money they finance for buyout are borrowed from banks or investment funds. So it is just like, I mean, old-fashioned Japanese corporate system in which cross-shareholdings completely shield Japanese corporate management from outside stock shareholders, but all the finance is made through indirect finance mechanisms, through banks, for example. Okay? So, I mean, this is not the legal problem, legal difference between Japan and it's not a matter of legal difference. It's a matter of choice, okay, in the country. I'm not sure I have answered your question.
Yes, I heard something. Yes.
Sorry, we are trying to get mic. Next question.
Professor Iwai, thank you very much. I myself am not an economist, but art historian, but I'm Korean. And as far as I know, Koreans studied very carefully Japanese corporation systems and their structure. Yeah. And the emergence of chaebol, so-called chaebol, in a way imitating Japanese system. In your expertise opinion, where are Korean corporations stay now?
Yeah, it's also a very interesting question because, I mean, Korean chaebol and Japanese zaibats before World War II are very similar. Okay? It is also another example of the use of corporate system. For example, it is a pyramidal structure of ownership and control. Okay? There's one family who owns holding corporation, and holding corporation owns many other subsidiary corporations, and then these subsidiary corporations own sub-subsidiary corporation, then pyramidal structure. And this is a way, the important point about this pyramidal structure is that there is a gap, there's a difference between control and ownership. In order to have a control over corporation, you don't have to have 100% ownership. You only need 51% of share. So if you have $1 million, okay, then you can divide that money into two $500,000 and buy two corporations, almost 50% of two corporations, and have control over two corporations. And thus this pyramidal structure is a way to enhance the family owners' power to control many corporations as well as many corporate assets. But then there was a sort of historical accident in Japan. Japan was defeated World War II, and American occupation army came and purged all Zaibatsu owners from their ownership. Then emerged this cross-shareholding Japanese corporate system. Okay? It's a corporate system which has no human family members to control and own the entire corporate system. So Chaebol and Japanese system is similar, but only Japanese system before World War II. After World War II, Japanese corporate system is a system which can be described as a system which has no real controlling shareholders. Okay? That's a crucial difference. Okay? And Chaebol system is quite similar to, for example, Italian family empire system. When I spent 6 months in Italy and I studied with Italian economists, and they try to compare Italian economy and Korean economy because they have very similar ownership structure. Okay?
Oh, you're going to bring me a microphone? That's very kind. I wanted to thank you for steering clear of one topic in particular, because I appreciated the philosophical and legal vocabulary that you were using to analyze these kinds of corporate governance. But I wanted to remind us all of a certain stereotypical way of talking about the differences between American and Japanese corporations. Yeah. That tends to reside in figurative language about the family, right? The standard stereotypical thing to say is that Japanese corporations are like families and American corporations are based on contract, and that leads into certain rather stereotypical views of the two cultures. So applauding you for having steered clear of that and found a neutral form of vocabulary that allows you to say something that puts both forms of governance on the same plane, yeah. I'm wondering if you could draw the discussion back a little bit closer to culture and maybe tell us something about the ways in which nominalistic and realistic trends in Japanese corporate governance, but also in Japanese society, are at work today.
I have to give two answers to this. One is, I have to emphasize that, I forgot to emphasize more that, I put parentheses on the Japanese, on the word Japanese. This is to indicate that, my intention is to make contrast between Japan and America, but my intention is to show you that nothing I have said, at least theoretical part of what I said, has nothing to do with Japan. Okay? So it can be applied without any modification to American system, European system, Korean system, and maybe Chinese system, if they become advanced capitalist economies. Okay? So that's one thing. But of course, I have to introduce some cultural elements. And the reason why Japanese society, Japanese economy has chosen this realistic form of cooperation has, some heritage, cultural heritage, historical heritage. It is family system. In fact, Japanese family system called Ie. Ie is a Japanese family system, and from outsiders, Japan, Korea, China, may look similar, but even from the standpoint of family system, there are a lot of difference. For example, both Japan and Korea have primogeniture structure in family system. Okay. So in that respect, we are very close. But there's fundamental difference. In the case of Japan, okay, the head of the family may not be the real son of his father or parents. Okay. Because in Japan, adoption was quite common in keeping family tradition, or family ties, or family lines. Okay? I think this is almost unthinkable in Korea. Okay? In Korea, maybe blood relationship seems very important, but in Japan, what matters is only name of the family. Okay? That is very important. If you, this is not a seminar on Japanese literature, but if you read Mori Ogai's, some famous Japanese author's book on Shibuya Chūsai, and you are surprised that the protagonist is very faithful keeper of family name, but the fact is he's only adopted son. Okay? And he tried to keep the family name, okay, even if he has no blood relationship. And in Japanese society, there are many such, and then in Japanese society and Japanese culture, there are many so-called family structures, just like a kabuki actor or sumo wrestlers. They always keep some names from one generation to another generation. So, and of course, people are different and even there is no blood lineage, but name or family or organization, okay, plays more important role. And that kind of family system, okay, may have played big role for Japan to choose realistic corporate form. Okay. But it is only one input into this choice. Okay.
You've been talking about corporations which are privately owned by shareholders, yeah, by many, many shareholders who are citizens. But it seems to me a lot, what you've said, the dichotomy also exists in state-owned corporations. So if you, for instance, look at PDVSA, the oil firm, the state oil firm in Venezuela, which was taken over, so to speak, by Hugo Chavez a couple of years ago. Before the takeover, it was very much, an example of a realist corporation, right? It was a corporation whose purpose was to expand itself and was very much controlled by the employees and the management. And then Chavez basically made it into a nominalist corporation in which the state shareholder becomes the dictating controller and uses the corporation for the benefits of the state, interpreted by Chavez. And I think you see also this same thing in China I don't know exactly how you'd analyze the transition in China from the old state-owned firms to the new version of state-owned firms. And also, I think there are other places. In Korea, the Pohang Steelworks, I think, was very much an example of a realist corporation. It was supposed to be expand and expand market share and be run as an exemplary corporation rather than simply being to serve the interests of the state. So do you have any, have you thought about applying these ideas to state-owned corporations?
Well, my opposition between realism and nominalism applied to, what I call nominalist corporation can be applied both to usually shareholder corporation as well as a state-owned corporation. Okay? So long as somebody has upper hand over organization, okay? It is very much like nominalist corporation, okay? Because I have written a paper choice of organizational form, okay, using Max Weber's theory of organization. And in fact, in organization theory, there are sort of two kinds of organization. One is organization which is instrumental to somebody higher up. Okay? So that somebody, some both maybe shareholders or state, as you mentioned. And the other form of organization is called autonomous organization. It is an organization which has its own agenda, whose objective is to its own survival or its own growth. Okay? So it doesn't matter, okay, whether owner, so-called owner, is shareholders or state. Okay? They are both. They can be classified as nominalist corporations because organization is just nominal in those cases.
Question. When I was raised, firms are everything. You have to devote, or family members also have to devote yourself to the firm. And the organization story of the firm was told not as a functional mechanism, but some kind of ideology to make people work, probably to resolve not only hold up problems, but also some moral hazard problems. But if you are doing those, referring to those survey enquete research, do you think that kind of firms as ideology or family as ideology aspect is missing?
Yeah. Well, yes, it's missing. But my answer is that, I mean, because I don't want to emphasize too much on the Japanese specific, I mean, family value. And what I try to say in this talk, although it's in such a short time, so I have to compress a lot of things, but I mean, in what I call post-industrial capitalism, even if it is very important, realistic cooperation is very important in post-industrial capitalism, but the form of realistic cooperation in post-industrial capitalism should be different from form of realistic cooperation in industrial capitalism. Because in industrial capitalism, okay, what I call human capital is very important, sometimes important, especially in Japanese corporate system, but they are always subordinate to factory system. Okay. So in post-industrial capitalism, this role has been completely, I mean, changed, and centrality is now placed on human capital and organization-specific human capital and organization itself.
I actually thought this was probably one of the best lectures I've heard, and I really appreciate how you tried to blend various other perspectives in to a talk that. And I really appreciate how you tried to blend other perspectives into what otherwise could have been a purely economics lecture. And I guess I'd like to pursue a line of questioning that's related to those other perspectives, along what Professor Sossi asked about, and to some extent, but also what Professor Hamada asked about. And you mentioned in one of your slides how in post-industrial society, the emphasis on human capital allows the firm to preserve at least some of its more realistic aspects that prevent it from sliding into American or pure nominalism. But at the same time, you mentioned one of the reasons for that is because human capital is inalienable. But one of the kind of discourses that exist on post-industrial society is, I think, precisely the fact that human capital is becoming alienated. And in fact, that's one of the crises and the problems of a post-industrial society, that with the growth of a service sector, for instance, we alienate our own kind of emotional labor, which is one popular example that came about from The Managed Heart, a book by Arlie Hochschild, I think. So I'm interested in why exactly you think that human capital is inalienable in some sense, and why, in fact, the new firm wouldn't slide towards an alienation of human labor and also in the form of knowledge instead of physical labor. And especially, too, related to this is within post-industrial society, depends upon a different type of physical capital in the form of various invisible technologies too, and I think this provides another link to the way in which technology in some sense, supersedes the need for various other forms of human capital and could, in fact, help alienate the worker, again, in post-industrial society.
Yeah, well, in fact, I mean, you talked about alienation and alienability interchangeably, but I mean, of course, etymologically, they come from the same proto-language, but I mean, alienation of workers and what I mean by alienability of employees and human capital is that those knowledge-based knowledge and ideas cannot be bought by money. Okay? And in the case of but this only applies to knowledge-based workers, knowledge-based employees, and maybe something about workers who are not be able to do knowledge-based things. They may be alienable and alienated in a sense. So what I call post-industrial society is not a sort of rosy society. It may have division of labor between two class of people: knowledge-based human capital and just human capital. Inalienable human capital and alienable human capital.
Result, this Pohang Steel Company in Korea is one of the most successful corporations I've known and I read, and it is exactly based on this human capacity and brain to that corporation.
Thank you very much. Yes, thank you very much for having answered me. Answer for
any
me, yes.
Other questions? I understand there is some deception upstairs. As a lecture on the Japanese studies, I was wondering when Japan comes in this lecture, and we are waiting, and last time, second slide, you can, but this discussion shows.
So he presented his paper in quite, if not technical, abstract, philosophical even manner. The content has universal relevance, not only to Japan, but many other countries and their institutions. We would like to thank Katsuhito again for his wonderful lecture.